Thanks for your company this Saturday morning. It is time now for Today Property Watch. And as the cost of living crunch takes hold, new data shows more Australians are swapping city skylines for suburban streets.
That's right, Jane. But is it paying off? To discuss, we're joined by Domain's property editor, Alice Stolz, in Melbourne. Morning to you, Alice. What are some of the pros and cons when it comes to a suburban move?
Good morning, guys. We're really talking here about sort of suburban heartland. We're not talking tree and sea change areas, and we're not talking those sort of inner city areas, but really in the depths of suburbia. And people who are interested in this are those sort of lifestyle buyers who really want to have a bit of backyard, a front yard, and space and a sense of community. So I think when it comes to the pros about that, affordability is a major thing that's driving people out there, as well as that sense of space, and also that lovely sense of community you can get from knowing your neighbours and all the kids walking to school together and all heading to the local shops together, and that ease of lifestyle that comes with living out there. Now, as for the cons, it can be a big adjustment, particularly if you've been living in a city or in, you know, having the convenience of city living for some time. Petrol costs, you'll have to get used to being in your car a lot when you're in the suburbs. Also, if you can't work from home, a commute to the office can take a lot longer. And I think it does have that sort of sense of convenience can be quite different if you've been living in the inner city.
So what does the data tell us about these kind of moves?
Well, Jane, really, we saw this during COVID that so many people took that plunge and moved further out. And what we're seeing is prices in these areas are really going up quite considerably in some areas. Now, we'll start off in Queensland. You can see in Lowood in the Somerset region, which is 66 k's west of the city. Now, the median house price in Brizzy at the moment is just over 800,000, so it's half that there. But that annual change is nearly 28%. In Sydney, areas like St George's Basin in Wollongong is up 14.8%, but you can get a house there for $845,000. Again, almost half the Sydney median. Victoria, have a look at Lynbrook, which is in the southeast of Melbourne, up 9.3% though, so people interested there need to be quick. And in South Australia, these are more regional areas like Tanunda and Margaret River in WA, also up 14%. So you can see that I think people often make that move when they're growing their family and they're just thinking now's the time to have that sense of space and to give up sort of apartment living or something for a compromise on their lifestyle.
Yeah, plenty to ponder, Alice. All right, let's take a look now at how the property market is faring. How were clearance rates last weekend?
Clearance rates were really, really strong. In particular, Sydney hit 75% last week, Melbourne 70%, Adelaide 68%, Canberra 61%, and Brisbane 56%. So we're really seeing selling conditions are continuing to strengthen. And again, low listings, but still really encouraging results for vendors. Now, auction numbers today, you can see in Melbourne 753, Sydney 572, and Adelaide 91. And again, Melbourne's up marginally on the week prior. So, and these numbers are actually sort of seasonally up compared to what they normally are this time of the year.
A bit cold standing outside in an auction this weekend, I would think.
You've got to do what you've got to do, though,
you sure do, Alice. What was the most expensive home to sell this week?
Yeah, an interesting property in Sydney you can see up here. It sold for, $8.35 million, and it's now in Cabarita in the Bayside suburb of inner west of Sydney. And I think we're probably going to see a bit of a change to that property take place, but you can see it's a real water sort of playground in front of that property there. Now, the most affordable home sold in Melbourne, it's $165,000, and this property sold in just two bids. And this could be Melbourne's cheapest home to change hands in some time, a one-bedroom apartment in South Kingsville. And it was bought by a father and son who were going to fix it up, the cracked walls, peeling paint. Mm. But for $165,000, pretty great way to get into the market, do something with your mum and dad if they're interested, and potentially make a little investment out of that property.
Got a bit of work to do, haven't they?
Bit of work.
They definitely do.
Kingsville's a very hip, up-and-coming suburb as well out there in Melbourne. What about the most wow homes on the market, Alice?
Yeah, some pretty, what a trio of great lineup today. We'll start off in Toorak in Melbourne. Beautiful trophy home with a pool and tennis court. On the market, though, for quite sort of a princely sum of $15 to $16.5 million, but it's set on 1,600 square metres of land. So you can really see in Melbourne, these prestige homes do have a lot of land with them. When you look at different areas around the country, you rarely sort of see those parcels like what we're seeing now. Now, we're going to go to Sydney, and this is the most epic home I think we've looked at in some time. It's on Avalon Beach, 6-bedroom, 5-bathroom. Now, it's got 30 metres of water frontage to Pittwater, and the most amazing views across Pittwater of Palm Beach, Lion Island, and this beautiful sort of, I think, mix of sandstone, timber and glass. And I think you could probably go fishing in your living room when you look at that shot there, if you really felt so inclined. And then we're going to go up to Queensland to Burley Waters, a beautiful home for 4-bedroom, 2-bathroom, pool with a diving board. Now, who would say no to a diving board if you're lucky enough to have a pool? And this actually home comes partially furnished. It's a bit of custom-built furniture in there. So half the work is done for you if you can afford to buy it.
That looks kind of like Tuscany on the Gold Coast, doesn't it?
It does, in Queensland, though.
Alice, thanks so much. Really appreciate
it. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, it's nice
daring
to dream.
Well,
in a little over a month, the cost to power your home is set to skyrocket, pushing many Australians to the brink. And we're not just talking about single-digit increases. Electricity prices will rise up to 25% across the country as energy regulators increase their default offers.
For more on this, let's bring in Major Brendan Nottle from the Salvation Army in Melbourne and Chris Ford from Compare the Market in Brisbane. Good morning to you both. First to you, Brendan. We're heading into winter now. Many already struggling, aren't they? How will this price hike hurt so many Australian families?
We're deeply concerned, Clint. We're hearing already that elderly people are saying we're not going to switch the heating on at all this winter. And we've got a cold front that's come across the eastern part of this nation already, and we're not in winter yet. And we're really concerned because this is life and death, Clint. This is not just about comfortability. This is actually life and death for so many people. And we're genuinely worried about what lies ahead.
Well, the Salvos are at the forefront of this cost of living crisis. What are you seeing, and what, apart, you, I know you just mentioned the heating, what else are you seeing, and what are the Salvos having to do? Where are you having to step in?
Oh, we're seeing a number of things at the moment. So our numbers are through the roof, and we've got over 2,000 centres right across the country. They're all reporting that the numbers are up. But the interesting thing for us is that we're actually seeing in our centre new faces. So people are coming in who are working full-time, but they simply cannot make ends meet. And the other thing we're seeing is people are foregoing the essentials of life. So I was with a young family last week who said that they've given up insurance on their car, and you think, oh, that's not a big thing, but they're doing it to survive. They've had their car stolen. Yeah. So now they're without wheels to actually get to work. So people are making, I'd say, rash decisions because they're panicking. They're really worried about what lies ahead, particularly with this really significant and exorbitant rate rise for electricity that lies ahead.
And, Brendan, at the worst end of all of this, I attended the Magpie's Nest there in Melbourne that does some incredible work, the Salvos. The foot traffic in there, extraordinary.
Oh, you saw it, Clint. That's what I'm talking about. And, you know, it's not just about people turning up for meals. It's not just about people sort of making these decisions that are really impacting them. It's actually their stress levels. Mm. So we're seeing people that are really, really on edge all the time. And you see that rolling out across, you know, the streets in the city, at schools, at sporting grounds. People are really on edge because I think they're genuinely concerned about how they're going to survive and how their kids are going to survive. And I think what lies ahead is a really serious issue. I feel like we're the canary down the mine and we're seeing things before others do. And I'm genuinely concerned.
Well, let's bring in Chris Ford now from Compare the Market. Chris, power prices are going up across the board. We heard from Brendan there how so many families are already struggling to make ends meet. Is there anything they can do? Is there still the option to find a better deal on their electricity?
Yeah, good morning, guys. Look, isn't it distressing to hear and they're same stories that we are hearing from customers? Yes, there is something we can do. This power price rise is coming from 1 July, like you mentioned, but, you know, to take this small bit of power that we have and to pay attention to the discounts that are available. Don't just take these hits lying down. See if you can do better. Looking around late yesterday, there are discounts off the reference price, north of 10%, sometimes 15%. I saw one in Melbourne, 21% with Origin Energy. These plans are moving very fast and will do in the lead up to the 1st of July. But these are some of the impacts that we can make. If we have solar panels, we'll make sure we're making the most of it, be it with our solar feed-in tariffs or utilising those energy-guzzling devices while the sun is shining. And then paying attention to some of the perks perks and incentives that are on offer. I saw one yesterday with OVO Energy, $190 bill credit that will be applied over the course of 12 months. These are small little wins that we can have. And if we continue to put those bills under the microscope, be it energy or across the household budget, hopefully we can find some relief.
So, Chris, if someone is struggling to pay their bills right now, this morning, what options do they actually have? Is it as simple as getting on the phone to their provider and asking for help?
Yeah, clear. These energy retailers will have hardship programs available. So contact your retailer at the first available opportunity. You don't want to just ignore it, put it on the fridge and forget about it. There is a chance that you could be disconnected if that's the case. So do contact your retailer. There's bill smoothing plans available as well. But also make sure you're making the most of rebates and concessions that are available through the state government. The federal government has indicated that there's more to come. In Victoria specifically, there's a $250 power saving bonus now that's available. So make sure you're making the most advantage of all of these things that are available.
All right, let's go back to Brendan. Brendan, we know the salvos do such a good job helping people who need it, but I would also imagine that with cost of living impacting so many people, is that affecting your donations?
It is, but that's the remarkable thing about Australians. I think when the going gets tough, Australians actually start to look out for each other. So there's this sense that, gosh, if I'm feeling it, there'll be somebody else somewhere that's doing it even tougher. And we've got a saying, this Red Shield appeal, that is nobody struggles alone. And that is so vitally important that if people are doing it tough, they actually reach out to us because we want to be with them and we want to do whatever we can to help. And if people are able to help us, to help others, that would be fantastic by simply going to Salvos or Salvation Army.
Brendan, I've known you for a long time. You wear your heart on your sleeve. You do some incredible work. But I just hear in your voice the emotion there. Supporting the most vulnerable in our community right now. How is it out there?
Oh, it's tough, mate. Like, when you got people saying, and this is not a one-off, I'm hearing this every day. People are saying, you know, I'm thinking I'm going to have to go to one meal a day and I'm actually giving up meals some days, they're saying to me. You think, this is not the country that we should be living in, you know? I think we're much better than this. And I actually think we need politicians of all political persuasions to actually take a breath and actually start to think, this is biting incredibly hard and we need their help. And I know what we're facing at the moment requires an all of community response. And all of us need to be doing our bit, but we particularly cry out to politicians today and just say, please, just be alert, be aware of how tough people are dealing with this at the moment.
Because it really is a certain cohort of people that's being squeezed by this. There's plenty of people who are doing very well who are not feeling so pinched by this cost of living squeeze, but there are a whole lot of people at the other end who are hurting the most. What do you want to see change? What could help?
Well, I think there's a couple of things. I think we need to make sure that we're not assuming that it's a particular cohort that's being impacted by this. We're seeing people from all different walks of life. And we're seeing people, as I mentioned, that are in full-time employment that simply can't make ends meet. They've trimmed back their lifestyle to survive and they're still struggling. And I think our cry to decision makers would simply be, please show compassion. Please understand that there may well be unintended consequences of your decisions and think them through. And that's not just political decision makers, that's decision makers at the head of energy companies, decision makers at the head of the Reserve Bank. We're simply saying, please, please, we plead with you, think about the unintended consequences of the decisions that you're making, because we're at the bottom of the chain and we're picking up the pieces and we're seeing those broken pieces every single day.
That is a very eloquent and passionate plea, Brendan Nottle from the Salvation Army. Let's hope our politicians, our company leaders and people who can afford it are listening and watching to you this morning. Thank you so much for your time.
Clint. Yeah, can I just say thank you to Brendan Nottle and the Salvos. They do some incredible work and that input this morning, that advice for struggling families, it doesn't go unnoticed. Thank you so much.